So, for our studio session in Big Data, I want to tell you things about smartphone data, because that is the most common data that we will encounter if we think in particular of surveillance. And of course, if you find yourself in industrial data science environment, you might use other big data sources, like maybe the temperature of a turbine or any kind of flight information, if it is the avionics environment or whatever. But thinking of interactive media, there is these two super strong data sources that tell about people's lives, and the one is social media, and the tool for that is particularly text mining and network analysis, which we will have a closer look using Python in the Jupyter notebooks in a separate video. And the one thing that we carry around all the time, of course, is our smartphone. So, and that collects all kinds of data all the time. So let's start looking at smartphone data, and just to introduce where the data actually comes from, I use this old Samsung device, several devices I dismantled until I came really down to share with you how the thing in the inside looks that is so pervasive. So breaking that up, so you see there's the battery, there's all kinds of electronics in it, and this L-shaped board was where I found most of the sensors that tell the stories about ourselves. And first we have the sensors that deal with the position of the smartphone. So you notice that when I turn the phone, the screen lights up, and also you have the pedometer that tells you how many steps you have taken. So the phone is aware of its position. And how does that work? It has a gyroscope and several accelerometers. We will look into these. And all these devices, like accelerometers, and also the compass and the like, are called MEMS. So that stands for micro electronic mechanical systems. So they are miniaturized electromechanical systems. And this electromechanical that tells you already where they come from originally, they come from car manufacturing, in particular from the airbags. So in the 1980s, cars started to become much safer by introducing all kinds of electronics that would make the car interacting with situations. So there is some kind of situational awareness of the car. For example, if the car bumps into something, then the airbags might blow up. But of course, you need to know that it is actually a collision. So that's a task. Is first you have to measure the acceleration. So that is, of course, a deceleration. So the car rapidly stops in a certain pattern. And then you have to detect the pattern that it is actually a collision and not just someone hitting their brakes and bringing the car to a stop without having a collision. So, and from these huge investments that the car industry took during the 1980s, developing airbags and many other features of the car, comes this miniaturization of these electromechanical sensors. Then we have the location-based services, and the location-based services have various levels, as we shall see. So one is the so-called global positioning system. The global positioning system works by measuring the distance in terms of the time difference in which certain radio signals reach this small antenna from satellites that orbit the Earth. So there's various competing global positioning systems. The first, of course, and most widely used is the one that the US brought up to the sky, that was initially a military positioning system, but was then opened for commercial use. And it allows the positioning within the range of maybe, say, a meter or so. So what this is an antenna that tries to connect to these satellites, I mean to receive at least three, but usually more, seven, eight or so of these satellites' signals to have a precise bearing on where you are. So that is only one of several layers of location-based services that the phone provides. And then we have the things that we think actually of a phone that is radio. So the phone has various radios. For example, you know that it has 4G because it shows you that in the connection to your service provider. So this is a digital protocol in a very high frequency, in the gigahertz frequency, that relays data from and to the phone. And one stream of this data is, of course, voice. That, I mean, like 15 years ago or so, before the iPhone, that was more or less the only data that would be relayed. So it was all voice, but the voice is also digital data. It is not analog. The analog mobile phones that existed in the 1970s have been switched off in every country, I think, at least since the mid-90s. So we have only digital phones now. And digital means that the voice data, the audio that you speak into the phone, is encoded, that it is transformed from the analog electrical signals into digital data. And then you have the Wi-Fi, you have Bluetooth. So the phone has all kinds of different protocols and different also, I mean, there's physically different wavelengths, different frequencies and so on. So that is various different radio functionalities and NFC that came later, which you use particularly handy to pay now with your phone, with Apple Pay or Google Pay. So these are the radios, and the radios are also used for location-based services because the companies that provide an interpretation, I will talk about that in a bit, like Google Maps or Apple, they have a global map of all radio signals that they know of. So they send around cars that measure all the Wi-Fi routers and their positions. So even if you don't have a very good GPS signal, because that is very difficult inside buildings, you might not have any GPS reception inside the building, because I mean the satellites are high up, and so that's a rather weak signal, although it is quite precise if you have it outside. So, but you might not have that, and Wi-Fi steps in then, and the phone triangulates the distance to these Wi-Fis that are also known to the mapping services. We shall look into that. And then you have other things, like for example the battery. You might not think of the battery as a sensor, but of course the battery is an electrical measuring the voltage of your battery, and by that determines how much your phone consumes in energy. Then there is an air pressure sensor, the compass, we look into that, a temperature measurement. I mean, even if your phone, I mean, like a very cheap Android phone or so, might not display you the temperature, but it has to have a thermometer inside because the phone has to prevent itself from overheating. So all phones have that. And then, of course, the microphone and the camera. And these sensors are always on, even if they don't send their data. Now we come into that. And I want to turn that around a bit and not so much concentrate on the senses as on the data and how to interpret it in a way that tells a story how people live. So the first layer of our data is the raw sensor data. And raw sensor data means that we have to understand a lot to make sense of it. So for example here, this is the battery drainage of my phone over the days. So you see, I unplug my phone, I leave for work, or I use the phone and the battery gets drained, and then I plug it in and it gets recharged. So if you look at these patterns that are of course measured not in percentage but can also be interpreted in voltage, you can not only see when I'm home, and probably when I'm asleep, because I don't use the phone, it's just plugged in. You can also see how I use the phone by the slope, by how much the phone actually drains the battery. And that's very telling. It has absolutely, it's an absolutely closely related to what apps you use and what you do with the phone. And you might think, yeah, well, that is maybe if you use voice or video, that has a specific pattern. But it is even more that the phone connects to the mobile base stations. These are usually these towers with antenna on top, which is the connection of your phone to the network of your service provider. And the further away the mobile base station is, the more the phone has to power up its antenna. And that drains too. And what you can do is you can triangulate the mobile base stations and find a specific pattern that tells where the phone is. It's not as precise, of course, as GPS or anything like that, but people can use it. So even if you have switched off all location-based services, your battery drainage, as long as your phone is connected, might very well tell someone who is interested in that where you are or where you have been, or at least give a good guess. The battery data is usually not sent out, so it stays on the phone. So it's not shared unless you grant this permission to an app. Of course, someone might just have access to your phone, like, for example, when you go to the US, the Department of Homeland Security harasses people by taking their phones away and downloading all the data that is stored on the phone, and then, of course, learn everything that they need or don't need about their lives. So let's look at another sensor, which is the compass. So this is the compass data, which is of course not a real compass like a needle or something like that. It is a very precise magnetic flux instrument that measures, and I will show you the raw data in life in a second, that measures the magnetic flux in three dimensions. And again, here you see the magnetic flux. So this was over the week on my phone. And you see these interesting spikes. So they are very telling. I mean, of course, this is only one dimension, so I only took the absolute magnetic flux in micro Tesla. And so you see, again, clearly, when I'm home, there is a certain level, and then I was clearly somewhere else, because the level is different. So you have these flat levels where I'm at one point, and then you have different levels at another point. So this is again very telling where you are. If you know the magnetic signature of a certain location, you can again interpret the data and find out what someone did. It's also very interesting if you enter a shopping mall or a shop in the mall. They have these barriers, these anti-theft barriers. You know that clothes or other expensive goods are tagged with these magnetic tags, and if you forget to pay, or if the cashier forgets to get this tag out, then it beeps when you leave. So this is a magnetic field. And if you have metallic implants in your body, you might even feel that. I know people who told me that that you can literally feel that in your body if you pass these barriers. It's not dangerously high magnetic radiation, but it's a magnetic field that is in the same range as the field of the magnetic Earth. It's in microtesla. So if you enter a shop, that shows, it has a very specific signature. You see that in the data. So now we have already started looking at the data and interpreting it in the way that we call an event. So if I enter a shop with the phone, that is an event. We call that an event. And this idea of events is that I have a pattern in the data that I can correlate to something that in abstraction I would call an event. For example, entering a store is an event. That's a very complex event. There's a lot going on when I enter a store. There is much simpler events. For example, the car has a collision. So if the car has a collision, I would say that's an event, and I have to find the pattern in the data that is a pattern detection task to know that this was actually a collision, or I would actually have entered the store. And the same is, of course, taking a step. For example, the phone counts the steps that I take. And of course, the phone can't know that I have taken a step. It is looking at these curves of the gyroscope and say, well, this curve is probably a step. And this step of abstraction, of interpreting the data, is called event processing. And there is even programming environments of complex event processing, for example, the language ESPER, which is a very commonly used, it's as all these languages, a bit JavaScript-like, but instead of having your website with your web events, like someone clicked here, or the movie starts to play, or so, this is your JavaScript events on in interactive media. Usually, with ESPER, you have these events that are physical, so to say, or data-driven. And so we are now in the realm of physical computing. You have output of your physical devices. You know that from Arduino, of course. But now we have the same thing going on the phone, and we have to interpret what's going on. That's usually done within an app. Here's another example. So this is not really raw data. That's something else that is already halfway interpreted. So this screenshot I took in my hometown, Munich, where I was at the place and just measured or let the phone kind of connect to the Wi-Fi or so. But the phone doesn't only connect to the Wi-Fi. It always tracks all other Wi-Fi signals around with all the information there is, and that includes, by the way, other people's phones. So even if you think you are not connected, so no one knows that you are there, there might just be someone else tracking your signal as well. And people might not even be aware of that. So what you see is tracked is on the one hand the SSID, which is this signifier, this label that you give your Wi-Fi router, like NYU, for example, or NYU guest or whatever. That is something that is arbitrarily assigned by you. Then you see all kinds of names that people give their Wi-Fi routers. And the interesting thing is that is already very telling. So, for example, if I analyze the data on the phone and I see that you frequently have the NYU router in the list, then I know that you are around NYU a lot. And what you, of course, immediately see also, if something is a residential building, then it has all these Wi-Fis that are very generic, like Netgear 7312 or something like that, because most people don't bother in renaming their Wi-Fi routers. But if you are in an office, you have totally different sets of Wi-Fi signals. For example, all the copiers, all the kind of the business machines in the office send out signals and are connected to Wi-Fi, and that completely changes the readings. I mean, also you have a very good guess how big the building is in which you are and how many people are there by just counting the density of the Wi-Fis available. So this is a very telling signal, of course the most left-hand column, the BSSID, this is a unique signifier. So this is a unique sign. Every router has this uniquely assigned, while the SSID is arbitrary, and this unique measurement of this of the BSSID is what Google or Apple use for location tracking. So if you assign a location to this BSSID, you can immediately detect if someone is there if this router shows up. So this, I mean, being in interpreting signals in that way is kind of understanding things as events. And if we have the next layer, I mean, events as such don't tell much. I mean, I tell you all these stories already, but I mean, you don't necessarily see that in the data on the event level. I mean, if, for example, the car crashes into the wall, that doesn't tell you much why it did that, or the circumstances of it. For example, if that is in a automotive test facility, or if it is on the street, or if there's another car involved, or if it is just a single car accident. So, and in a way, you can say, I mean, like the location data, I mean, here this is, for example, location data on my phone. So you see that I move. I mean, you could also put the speed on, I mean, how quickly I change. It's just a grid of latitude and longitude. So you see me moving, I come up from southeast to the northwest, and then I start moving in kind of a random way and go down a bit. But of course, this doesn't tell you much. I mean, you don't know where I am here. I mean, even if I would put in the latitudes and longitudes, so it's I think it's about 9 degrees eastern longitude and about 50 degrees northern latitude, you could look up and see, well, that is North Rhine-Westphalia in the northwest of Germany, but they still don't know much. But if I put a map underneath, you see immediately what happened. So it's me flying to Düsseldorf. So I take a plane to Düsseldorf and then I move around on the airport and then I take the train into the city and then walk a bit. And you only see that with map data. And this is context. And data storytelling gets only good if you have context. So context makes data talk. And this is also, of course, I mean, it's necessary that you trust your context, that you know that the map is a different source. You have your own tracking data and you are in control of the tracking data. You are not so much in control of your map data. And context can be very complex. I mean, here, this is a research project that I used to work on some years back. I mean, where we use these phone data and then Wi-Fi data and other data that we collected to reconstruct a person's walk through the city and what they did, in particular, which shops they visited. So this is, of course, context. I mean, the phone doesn't tell you that as such. And now we come to context that is even richer and that is not even related to like just knowing where someone was and mapping that, because it still doesn't tell you why I was in Düsseldorf. And the phone probably, if you would have access to the calendar data, you might see it, but you might not, because I might not have it in the calendar in a way that is really telling. So there is always this step in data science where you have to get above that or beyond that. And that is the rich context. And I just have this example. What we did was exactly using these apps to make kind of sense of what people did. It was a market research project for a large airport. And the airport wanted to understand what people coming from East Asia, I mean, namely from China in particular, what they would do. So they would fly into Germany, into Frankfurt actually. Hundreds of thousands of people come from China into Frankfurt, but no one knows or knew what they would do. And of course, for marketing, that's very interesting. And so we would ask people in China if they would be interested in taking part in this market research and just allow us to track them and to ask them then questions. And the questions we asked was all the soft context that you need to understand to make sense of what people did. Like they go to a shop, but you don't know if they bought anything there. But that's of course very interesting. And if they bought something, it's also interesting how they were treated. How was their experience? I mean, did they have language issues? Did they face maybe racism or resentments? Did they find it easy to get around? And all these things that you need to understand why some people, for example, might do a lot of things and get around well and others don't. So understanding the subjectiveness of data is something that has, I think, to be done explicitly. So while I would say Google mostly looks in a very mechanical way into, for example, what people write in Gmail or what people search or so, and then just makes assumptions in this mechanical way. I mean, okay, this person looked at these search results and then clicked. I mean, that doesn't tell you why. And I think this is why a lot of the things that Google does seems so repelling, at least to me. Because you always have the feeling that they make assumptions about you that are actually wrong. And I think if you want to do good app design, if you want to really understand what people do, if you want to have marketing that is not intrusive but helps people, then it is really crucial that you don't only respect privacy and self-determination. I think this is the basic minimum, but that you also allow people to tell you what they feel and what they want. And this is traditional market research. This is traditional surveys. And these surveys, they are of great value. And there is this idea of the Midas touch. You know, King Midas, who was cursed that everything he touches turns into gold. And you could think of data, I mean, that is a story that someone used in the talk, I appropriate that from them. So you could think of big data, this is usually these heaps of data, and even if you have a lot of math and machine learning running over them, they really never tell you much. And in particular, there might be data that is more or less flawed, but it's very hard to tell. And so the trick is with surveys and other traditional market research method to have highly curated and very good but small data sets and use these to turn your heap of data, you can think of that as like being in a haystack or whatever, to turn that from what it was into gold, so to say. So this is the Midas touch. So you have something that touches the data and the data becomes much better and much more valuable. And I think this is an interesting turn. I mean, of course, what I showed you, Palantir, that's exactly what they do. So what Palantir, of course, does is they don't only have these measured data that the NSA collects in the large data vaults, but they have all these phone calls of people and other direct surveillance in which the spies tap into. And they have real people sitting there listening and making interpretations and matching that with the data they collect. And by that, it becomes valuable. So just collecting the data and having machine learning run over it might look great and it's comparably cheap, But it doesn't do the trick. The trick comes in having actual people, analysts, sitting there and bringing together what they see on images, what they hear in their phone tabs with the data they collect. And by that, it becomes so powerful. And I think this is very much underestimated, that it is not so much about these petabytes or yottabytes of data that the NSA collects, but it is about like 250,000 analysts sitting at the NSA offices and actually doing the job of analyzing with their minds, not with machine learning. And what Palantir developed is this very simple to use dashboard to make that an easy task. So this is the data storytelling part that I want to introduce you. And now I want to show you a bit the actual data of the smartphone. So I have shared my iPhone screen with you, and so you see familiar screen, and so I have a few apps here. These two apps, Sensor Kinetics and Sensor Logs, they are totally simply just reading the phone sensor as far as iOS lets you. Android is much, much more giving away. iOS is kind of protective and interpret. So let's just open and start with the first sensor reading. So that's the accelerometer. That means linear acceleration. So that means it tracks if the phone accelerates. So that means changes its velocity. And let's just see, to change the phone, its velocity in the horizontal. And you see that the horizontal, the green line, so it's maybe a bit faster. Let's now turn the phone. Of course, that's also an acceleration. Come into that in a bit. What we do now is in the vertical. And of course, it has a third. So you see, that's the acceleration. And I'm thinking of if the phone moves and then stops, that's also an acceleration. That's of course a deceleration. So that's the linear acceleration. So the second is the gyroscope. So the gyroscope does something different. The gyroscope measures angular momentum. So if I keep the phone just straight, I mean, even if I move it, the gyroscope doesn't say anything or much. I mean, of course, I'm not perfect in moving. But if I turn the phone, so you see that I turn the phone, it has a very specific pattern that it creates. So, and if you think of sitting on a swing, for example, and also think of the linear acceleration here, sitting on the swing, or maybe I can have the phone swing like a pendulum. So then you see the green line creates this kind of wavy figure. So the gyroscope and the raw, the linear acceleration are the two measures of position of the phone in regard to its inertia. So that means they would work even on, in outer space without gravity, because acceleration, of course, exists, independent of gravity. So, which is important because if you think of the development, the airbags, that's exactly how you detect a collision. But if you think of having the phone in your pocket and pulling it out, this is one of the events that you want to track. That's how you do it. And you are not so much interested in if someone is lying down or standing up or sitting. The pulling out of the phone should kind of create a detectable pattern. So, and if you think of the step, I mean, this is how the step, so to say, in raw data looks. It's like, and of course there is no step there in the data. It's just the pattern of these the three dimensions of accelerations. So, and then we have the magnetometer, which is this magnetic field instrument that I told you. So you see the magnetic field here. I'm quite high up here already in the eighth floor. So you could detect that. If you know the standard magnetic flux on campus, you could already see that I'm above Earth with that. And so I turn the phone around, and you see how the orientation of the magnetic field changes with that. And by that, the compass is gauged, so by that the compass knows its bearing. So here you have already the interpretation. By the way, if you look down, you see, for example, the sampling rate, which is 30 hertz. That means there's 30 data points per second. If you program an app, you can lower that so that the app will use significantly less power. That is, when apps detect, for example, that the phone gets into low power mode, then they reduce usually their consumption of data by lowering the sampling rate. So, so we see the phone moving, and these already, I mean, highly processed interpretations of the data showing you the movements in acceleration and change in pitch, so in change of angular momentum and position relative to the Earth's magnetic field, this is the data that you use to detect what a step is. So because the raw data is very hard to interpret, here Apple has done already something, and the phone has a special processor. It has a separate processor that does nothing else than deal with the sensory input and making sense of them. So here, what you clearly see is that is the microphone. So you see the microphone is monitored as well. And of course that can tell you a lot of things if you're interested in what's going on, like the environment in which someone is. I mean, there's a lot of things that you can do with the microphone inputs other than just listening to people. And this is the compass interpretation. I mean, now we have the, you see the four axes of the magnetic flux in microtesla. But what the phone automatically does is interpret that as the bearing. So so I can basically turn the phone and get and know where I am actually. So, and this is now the context level. So what the phone shows you here is the so-called motion types. So the phone processes the data, so you can access the raw data, you can access the interpreted, the analyzed data, and it spits out also these motion types, which means now, for example, with high confidence, the phone is kind of stationary, but unknown, since I'm moving it all the time. So, but if I walk, let's walk for a while, The interpretation, hopefully, should change to walking. It's not particularly high confidence in walking, but since I'm walking on the step, but now it gets green. So the phone thinks now I'm walking and is counting my steps. And running, yeah, and the interesting thing is automotive, which is, I mean, Apple is a US-based company and is particularly based in a part of the US where there is just absolutely zero public transport. And so people working at Apple are obviously totally unable to think that someone might have a different way of transportation for themselves as either exercising or driving their car. I mean, this is kind of their California bias. What I did in several apps is I used these patterns that Apple uses to detect automotive, because that is just acceleration and velocity. I mean, if you accelerate more than, say, like 25 kilometers per hour and don't move much, then you are not cycling, then you are clearly in a car. But Apple thinks that you are in a car if you are in the train as well. I mean, because they don't know trains. But the train has a totally different moving pattern than the car. First of all, it accelerates not at the same kind of level. It accelerates a bit slower and more more continuous. And a train, in particular a commuter train, has a very specific pattern of regular stops. And if you combine that in particular then also with the sounds, then you get a very precise motion type of someone in a train. More tricky, of course, is someone in a bus, but of course you could do that as well. So this is already kind of the event in a very complex way. So the event of the phone being stationary or in the state of walked, or even further. And if you use another device, like for example Fitbit, there's other motion types. For example, swimming. You can't take your iPhone swimming, so it wouldn't make sense, but a Fitbit has that, for example. So this is, if you think of our levels, we have the raw data, we have simple events, these are complex events. So let's just move further. So altitude, I mean, you think where I am here, 8th floor, I'm about at sea level, I think. Here you see the air pressure. The air pressure sensor of the phone, I think, is not super precise, but it's certainly better than your average barometer. And that is, of course, the location-based services that show you where we are. I mean, very precise. I'm building B2. And you see the accuracy, which is about 10 meters in vertical. So, and I guess, I mean, in an environment like here, you know, the routers here, they're probably not all mapped and they all only say NYU or so, so you might not know that well. And clearly I wouldn't have much of a GPS bearing inside. And really interesting also is that the horizontal, I mean the altitude measurement, is actually not great. So it says that I'm 12 meters above sea level. I mean, looking outside, I mean, that seems about right. But there is a huge insecurity here with 65 meters. So, and this is then, of course, the step counter, because I'm not taking any steps really. Other sensory data that I showed you in the beginning, like the IP addresses, the device orientation, the landscape, portrait, face up. So you see the different events that the device makes sense of in terms of their position. And that's it as far as this app goes. I have a second app, Sensor Kinetics, that looks a bit less fancy, but it's also quite good. It has a few other things that it does quite well. I mean, like these very nice visualizations. So, for example, here, I mean, of course, gravity for the phone is also acceleration. I mean, which it is. I mean, you know, this is gravity is measured in acceleration towards the Earth. But it's a very special acceleration. This is the kind of the constant, and the phone's gravity measure is, so to say, giving orientation to the other acceleration data, like the gyroscope and the linear acceleration. So if I accelerate the phone, you see this ball moving in this three-dimensional visualization. And if you look at Apple's documentation on the developer pages, you find a lot of information how to implement that. I mean, it is not totally easy in iOS. It's much simpler in Android to create an app and upload that, but there is tools where you can develop apps, your simple app, and try them out on your own phone. Of course, it is a totally different story if you actually want to make the app available in the Apple Store. If you look up development environments, there is things that bridge that gap by which you can also simulate the phone's behavior on your Mac and so on. And here, I mean, I just pulled out this page just to give you an idea how the description is. It's very thorough, I think, and you find tons of examples, of course, on the internet, how people actually included these functions, these iOS-specific functions, into their code. So this was my brief overview on smartphone data and the aspects of physical computing in our mobile devices. In the next video, next studio video, I will introduce a bit what I would call street fighting data science. So if you have data and want to start exploring that on your own, how to approach that by using Python.